All right, welcome back to my talk. So I'll go ahead and get started here. Again, like I said before, the title is Parking Functions and Some Interesting Generalizations. Okay, so just some background is where we'll start from. I'll talk about cars parking on a one-way street and also see how parking functions are related to this nice communitary object called lattice pads. And specifically, we'll look at dig paths and label dig paths. And then we'll go ahead and look at some generalizations and connections of parking functions. And lastly, I'll look specifically at my work or my research, which is involving contrived polynomials and parking functions, and some other generalizations, which are parking completions as well as parking sequences. So these are the things I want to go over in this talk. And at the end, I'll answer some questions like I've been asked to. All right, let's go dive right into it. So let's talk about cars parking on a one-way street. So in this picture, you have N cars, A car one, car two, and so on up until car N. And each of these cars are attempting to park on a street with N spots. Now notice that this is a one-way street. Now, each car has a preference, A1, A2, and car N has A N. So based on the preference, the parking process tells us that the first car will start at spot A1. So all of these spots, A1, A2, and so on, all of these are numbers that lie in this set 1, 2 up until N. So car one will start from spot A1 on this street and then move forward. So what that means is that this car starts to probe from spot A1. If it's empty, it parks there. If it's not empty, then it moves to the next available spot and then parks there. Now, if every car is able to park based on their preferences, not necessarily where they prefer, but at least somewhere on the street based on this preference, then we will call that preference sequence a parking sequence, a parking function for me, a parking function. Okay, and so that's the process. So this is really what's happening here. So let me go and give a more formal definition. So a sequence A1, A2 up until AN is a parking function if at least I terms in that sequence is less than or equal to A_i. Or another way to see it is that if you rearrange this sequence in its non-decreasing rearrangement, A_1 is the smallest, A_2 is the smallest number, and so on up until A_n, then this rearrangement will satisfy A_i is less or equal to I. And we will see this example shortly to kind of see how this works. Yeah, because an example will really make this clear to us. So let's look at this example real quick. So assuming, for example, let me use 1, 3, 1 and see why this is a parking sequence. So when N is 2, you have these three sequences. Parking functions. When N is 3, you have this number of parking functions here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So there are 16 parking functions. And there's actually something going on here, and we'll see it in a bit. Okay, so let's try to park using this preference sequence. So you have a street with three spots, 1, 2, and 3. So car one has preference one, car two. So let me write this below. Car one has preference one, car two has preference three, car three has preference one. So car one parks here because one is open. Car two wants spot three, so car two parks here. Now car three wants spot two. Car three wants spot one, and spot one is occupied. And so it has to move forward by one spot. So car three parks here. And so we say this is a parking function. So let's try something else and see. What if I said my preference sequence is 1, 3, 3? Let's try this. So we have a street again with three spots. The first car wants to park on spot one, so that's fine. The second car wants spot three. Now the third car wants spot three, but it's occupied. So the third car has to leave the street. And so we say this is not a parking function. Okay, so essentially, this is how we'll see how parking functions work. And one important thing or property of parking functions is that any permutation or any rearrangement of a parking function is also a parking function. And you can go through these examples when n is 2 and n is 3 to see how this is or how this works. Okay, so let's move ahead to the next slide. Let's talk about dyke path. So a dyke path of semi-length n is a lattice path in the grid Z2 with E steps and not steps. So essentially, E steps are what you want them to be, the step that goes from here to the right just by one unit, and a not step are steps that go from here up by one unit. Okay, so you can essentially write a dyke path. So a dyke path is going from the origin 0, 0 to n. So essentially, it's a box, and it's a path that lies in this box. But the requirement is that the path must never dip below the diagonal, that is the line y equals x. So this is an example of a dyke path here. And you can actually, instead of drawing it out, you can denote this by the word of length 2n with letters n and e, where n denotes your not steps and e denotes your E steps. So for example, here you have n, and then you have e, n, e, n, e, e, and that's what you have here. That is this dyke path. Okay, so this is really interesting because we've gone from talking about parking functions and we've gone to dyke path. So the question really is, what's the connection? And that's the next thing I want to talk about. But before that, I'll talk about labeled dyke paths. So labeled dyke paths are just dyke paths that have labels on them. Okay, but what specific labels do you use? So we're going to be using this set n. So wherever you see this, wherever we see this, let me write this down. Wherever you see this, this represents the set. This is the set 1, 2, 3, and so on up until n. Okay, so anywhere you see this in this term. So we're essentially labeling the not steps of the dyke path using these numbers 1, 2, 3 up until n, and we don't repeat any number. So where do these numbers come from? Well, we'll see that later, but that's really what happens here. That's a labeled dyke path. So for example, in this case, I can these two represent if you have, like I said earlier, car 1, car 2, car 3, and car 4. Okay, so what this will mean is that I can actually use this to represent the preference of cars. So if a car says, well, they want to park in spot 1, so this is car 2 says they want to park in spot 1, car 4 says they want to park in spot 1, then I can write this as the parking function where there's a 1. So this is first spot, second spot, third spot, fourth spot. So first, there's a 1 here because this corresponds to 1, this corresponds to 2, this corresponds to 3, this is 4, this is 5, and so on. So essentially, well, you're going, this is 1, okay, and this is 1, which means that the second car has preference 1. The fourth car has preference 1. Then when you go to the second column, the first car has preference 2. So the first car has preference 2. And lastly, the third car has preference 3. So this right here, it turns out, is a parking function of length. And this is not an accident. And that's the next thing. Okay, so let me clear up this so that I can move to the next page. So, like I said, this is not an accident because it turns out our classical parking functions are in bijections with labeled dyke paths. So I'm not going to go into the foolproof, but it's really not hard to see. So this is the parking function, right? 2, 3, 5, 4, 1, 4, 2, 6. You can confirm that it's the case. Remember, we said something is a parking function if the number of items or the number of terms that are less than or equal to I are greater or equal to I. So let me say that again. You have a sequence is a parking function if there are items, there are at least items that are less or equal to I. So if you look at this, for example, this is a parking function of length 8. Why? Because there is one term that is less or equal to 1. There are three terms. This is 1, 2, 2. So there are three terms less or equal to 2, which is fine. There are four terms less or equal to 3. There are five terms. So, well, how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There are six terms less or equal to 4. Okay. There are seven terms less or equal to 5. And lastly, there are eight terms less or equal to 6. Sorry. Well, there are six. There are eight terms less or equal to 8. Actually, less or equal to 6 in this case, which is fine. So if you go through the second definition I gave earlier, then you can just look at this as, let's take the non-decreasing rearrangement. Okay, so let me write this here. So the non-decreasing rearrangement here will be 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, so what does this mean? Well, we want this to be less or equal to 1. That's fine. We want this to be less or equal to 2. The next one less or equal to 3. The next one less or equal to 4. This less or equal to 5. And this less or equal to 6. This less or equal to 7. This less or equal to 8. And based on this, then we can conclude that this sequence is a parking function, since its non-decreasing rearrangement satisfies less or equal to this. Okay. So this is, maybe I should, let me erase that and do this. So this, let's see. Okay, so I said this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And this is less or equal to this sequence. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so this is a parking function of length 8. And then this is essentially what it says, just like I explained earlier. Now, if you can easily label all of this, and of course you want to make sure that if you're labeling a certain column or a certain vertical run, you label from smallest to largest. So in this case, what we're saying is that the first car and the seventh car, so if you label this 1, 2, 3, 4, then this is 5, this is 6, this is 7, and 8. Okay. The first car and the seventh car have preference 2, and that's why they appear here. Okay. The fifth car has preference 1, that's why it appears here. Okay. The second car has preference 3, that's why it appears here, 2 appears here. The fourth and the sixth car have preference 4, and that's what we see here. And same thing for the third car and the eighth car. Okay, so that's one direction. The other direction is not difficult. The other direction simply says, if I have a label dike path with labels using 1 to n, okay, where n is from your n comma n, whatever this number is, then you're essentially saying you have a parking function, because this will be a parking function if and only if this does not dip below the line. Because when it dips below the line, we violate this less than or equal to property. So this is essentially what's happening here. So this gives us a unique parking function, and any unique parking function can be represented as a labeled dike. Okay, so I hope that is clear. And let me say that actually, like I said earlier, when I was talking about when n equals 2, there were 3. When n equals 3, there were 16 parking functions. Actually, there's a formula for that, and that is n plus 1 to the n minus 1 parking functions of length n. Okay. Now, if you know a little bit about graph theory, this number might ring a bell. And that's true, because this is connected to trees or rooted trees. And we'll talk about that just briefly in a little bit. Okay. So let's move on and talk about just something that we can get following this. So a corollary to what we just talked about is that increasing parking functions and bijection with dike paths. So what are increasing parking functions? It's essentially parking functions written in increasing order. So that's the one I just wrote earlier on. 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So, increasing parking functions are in bijection with bike paths. Why is that the case? Well, just think about this labeled bike path and take away all the labels. Then that's exactly the same thing as rewriting all of this in increasing form. So, for example, that would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And so we have an increasing labeling. So because we know it's increasing, we might as well just take away the label since we know what to do. It's a unique label. And essentially, that corresponds to the case where the first car prefers the first spot. So one, the second plus next two cars prefer, so this will be 2, 3, and that will be the expression 2, 2, okay, for 2 and 3, for the second and the third car, and so on. So this would be that specific increasing parking function. We wrote 1, 2, 3, sorry, 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so awesome. The interesting thing about increasing parking functions are that they are in bijection with dike paths. Okay, so what does that mean? It means that, like I said, there are Okay, sorry, let me back up and say that again. So increasing parking functions are in bijection with dike paths. And there are C sub n dike paths of semi-length n. What's C sub n? Is the nth Catalan number. The Catalan numbers are a very important set of numbers in combinatorics. And they show up, I mean, not only in combinatorics, but a lot of places in mathematics. Okay, so the nth Catalan number is 1 over n plus 1, 2 n, choose n. And these numbers are very important, and they have a lot of generalizations. Okay, so I'll move further and talk about generalizations of parking functions. And I'll focus specifically on vector parking functions, and after that, I'll talk about some other generalizations that we have. Okay, so first, to talk about vector parking functions, let's have a vector called U. Okay, so these vector parking functions are also known as U parking functions. And so U is a given non-decreasing sequence. Okay, now, if you have any sequence and we have its non-decreasing rearrangement, we'll call that the order statistics of that sequence. So, well, U is already a non-decreasing sequence, so that's fine. So U1 is the first order statistic, U2 is the second order statistic, and UN is the nth order statistic. Okay, so let's go ahead, excuse me, and talk about what's the definition of a U parking function. So a U parking function is essentially like you're trying to park cars on a longer street. And a U parking function is just any preference that is bounded by other statistics. So, and I'll give an example shortly, but the formal definition just says, instead of where you had I earlier, where we said x sub I is less or equal to I for all I, just replace that by the I term in this U vector. And that's a U parking function. So again, if your U sub I is I, we get the classical case. So let's look at an example where that is non-trivial. So if your vector U is 2 comma 5, so that means we're looking for parking function of length 2. Okay, all parking functions of length 2 that can park on a street of size 5. So we can assume that 5, which is the largest pin here, is the largest part of the street. So this street has length 5. So let's give an example here. Okay, so assuming that here this is our street, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. And we want to park two cars, remember, on this long street. But we have this constraint. Our car with the smallest preference has to have preference less or equal to 2. Our car with the largest preference has to have preference less or equal to 5. Okay, so let me do 4, 2, for example. Okay, this is a parking function. Why? Because essentially, if I want to park the first car, it has preference 4. So C1 and then C2. So I can park the first car here. The second car has preference too, so I can park the second car here. And we're good because the first car ends up, the car with smallest preference is parked on or before 2. The car with largest preference is parked on or before 5, or has preference on or before 5, and it's parked on the street. So this is a parking function, a U parking function for your U equals 2, 5. Now, let me give a different example. What if I said 5, 3? Okay, so let's look at the sequence 5, 3. Well, let me erase this and let's see what happens on this street. Okay, so we want to park on this street. There's a little bit of a difference now. Okay, so just a second. Okay, so what happens here is that we have same street length, but now So we have the same street length, but the constraints we have say that the first car, like before, so we're still using our U to be 2, 5. Okay, so let's see what happens if we try to park 5, 3 on this street. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we want to park on this street. 5, the first car has preference 5, so it parks here. The second car has preference 3, so it parks here. So really, they're able to park. However, this car has preference greater than 2, which was what we wanted originally. And 2 is still, 1, 2 are empty. Okay, so what does that mean? This is not a U parking function for this U. However, if I change my U to, let's say, 4, 5. So let me change my U here. And let's do a new thing. So if I used, let's say, a V as a new vector here. So let's say V is 3, 5. Okay, and I'm trying to park the sequence of 5, 3, okay? The same sequence here. Then I have this street, again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so I'm able to park the first car as before. Now, remember that there's something here. Okay, so we have to have the first car, the first car parks on spot 5. The second car has preference 3, and this time around, V is 3, 5. So again, I'm making this mistake. Let me erase this. So let's see. So 2, 3. Just a second. Okay. Okay, so I want to park here, and my constraints are that the first car, or the car that has the smallest preference, has to be less or equal to 3. The car with the larger preference, its preference has to be less or equal to 5. That's really what this V says. So I try to park the first car, it has preference 5, so it parks here. I try to park the second car, it has preference 3, and so it can park here. And so 5, 3 is a parking function when V is 3, 5, even though it was not a parking function when your vector U was 2, 5. So you can see that you can have the same vector be a parking function for some vector, but that sequence is not a parking function for another vector. So I hope this is clear with this illustration. Okay. All right. So let's go ahead to the next slide. So, like I said, there are several other generalizations and connections that parking functions have, and they found so much usefulness in combinatorics and even other parts of mathematics. Actually, the original parking function study came from computer science. And so there's connections between parking functions and hashing functions, which has to do with storage problems in computer science. So I should have said that, because that was originally where this problem came from. Hashing functions came up in the work of Cunningham and Weiss in the 1950s, where they were looking at storage problems in computer science. And so hashing functions is looking at it from the combinatorial perspective of the same hashing functions. All right, so like I said earlier, the number of hashing functions is n plus 1 to the n minus 1, and that's because there's actually a bijection between hashing functions and rooted forests, okay? Or rooted trees. So I won't go into that, but also there's the notion of hashing functions on graphs, or graphical hashing functions. And it turns out that the specific case that we looked at, the classical case, is when your graph is the complete graph on n vertices. That is the graph where you have n nodes, and you have every node has there's an edge between every node and every other node. Okay, there's also some recent study is about parking that allows backward movement. So remember, when cars park using the parking process we described earlier, they start to probe at some spot and then they move forward. Some people have worked on this. I think Professor Harris, together with some of our students at the MSRIUP last year, I believe, worked on this kind of parking, where they call it, I think, Naples parking, Naples parking function. So this is where a car can be able to probe for a number of spots behind before it moves forward, if it doesn't find space. There's also parking that has been studied on other tree structures by Lackner and Panholzer, and by Westin King and Yan. Also, there's parking distributions on trees that have been studied by Butler and Ron Graham and Yan. So there's a lot of study on parking on other tree structures. And essentially, what this is the fact that when you look at the original parking functions and you look at a one-way street, it's really saying you're parking on a graph, which is a path graph. Okay, so it's a path with n nodes on it. And then a number of people have said, well, what happens if the structure you have is not just a path, but another tree structure? And then people have studied this kind of result. Another thing that is important, which I'll talk about shortly, is Goncharov polynomials and their relations with parking functions. And I'll skip that, and parking completions, parking sequences. These are things that I'll talk about shortly, because these are where my work lies. There's also connections with non-crossing partitions, diagonal harmonics, and hyperplane arrangements. So this is arrangements of lines in the plane, or if you want, hyperplanes, okay, in space. So particularly Xi arrangements are in bijection with parking functions. Non-crossing partitions are in bijections with parking functions, and so on. You can look at a number of things that have been studied on this. All right, so I'll go ahead and talk about my own work. So my research has been mostly in these three areas, Goncharov polynomials and parking functions, as well as parking completions and then parking sequences. So let me talk about Goncharov polynomials. Now, Goncharov polynomials come from the concept of Goncharov interpolation. So Goncharov interpolation essentially says, it's essentially a special case of Hermite interpolation. So you're not just differentiating at some point or trying to interpolate a number of points and get some result, but you are looking at the ith iteration of something, some kind of linear operator, okay, called a delta operator. So, excuse me, let me explain a little bit more what this means. So think about it like you're giving two sequences of real or complex numbers. So let's say sequences Z's and B's. And then there's a delta operator delta. Now, when you take, so think about delta operator as a generalization of your differential operator. Okay. So when you do the ith iteration of the delta operator, essentially you apply delta I times to a polynomial. Okay, and evaluate that what you get at the point zi, and then that speaks out for us b sub I. And the question really is, we want a polynomial of degree n that will do this for us. It turns out that the unique solution, when your bi is specified as n factorial Kronecker delta n comma I, this unique solution for this problem is called the nth continualized Gontcharov polynomial. Okay? All right. So this problem is called the generalized Gontcharov interpolation problem. And so the polynomials, like I said, are that satisfy this, that the nth generalized Gontcharov polynomial, or if you want to consider all of those polynomials together for all n, then you call them the sequence of generalized Gontcharov polynomials corresponding to this delta and to this number z. So let me give just an overview of the big picture. What my work was here, or what my objective was here, was to be able to find combinatorial interpretation for these Gontcharov polynomials. And I'll explain the motivation briefly. So there are this set of polynomials called basic polynomials, or polynomials of binomial type. These are polynomials that behave like the binomial theorem, or satisfy an expression like the binomial theorem. So, for example, let me just give the simplest example that corresponds to the power polynomials, essentially, which corresponds to the differential operator. So, again, like I said, when you're thinking of delta, just think about it as a generalized form of your differential operator D. So, whenever you're given a polynomial of binomial type, in this case, x to the n, which is the power polynomials, it will correspond, the basic polynomials here will correspond to a delta operator. So there's a one-to-one relationship here. So, well, a delta operator, like I said, is a linear operator that acts on some polynomial and reduces the degree. So in this case, specifically, if you do d of x, n, we know will be n x to the n minus 1. Okay? So you can look at other, there are other examples of this delta operators. Okay, so for example, you have the shift operator e sub 1 minus I. The shift operator e sub a is just shifting a function f of x, sending this to f of x plus a. Okay, if this is the shift operator e sub a. Okay, so this is another example, okay? And I believe this corresponds to the polynomial called the lower factorials, okay? X lower n. So the lower factorials are given by x times x minus 1 times x minus 2 and so on times x minus n plus 1. So this is what we have here, okay? All right, so when you do this, you will actually get n x to the power of n minus 1, lower factorial. So essentially, this is the relationship, a one-to-one relationship from polynomials of binomial type and their corresponding delta operators. Now, there is, like I said earlier, there's a generalized Gontcharov polynomials can be gotten from Gontcharov interpolation, which involves delta operators. And now, by the work of Lorentz, Tringali, and Yan, you can do a linear transformation that takes you directly from basic polynomial to the Gontcharov polynomial that's associated with it. So this says that essentially, this first half of this picture is what I just explained. If you're given a basic polynomial, there's a delta operator that's related to it uniquely. If you are given a grid Z, that is attached to that delta operator, then you get the Gontcharov polynomials T sub n that are uniquely related to it. And I said, there are basic polynomials that, like from your basic polynomials, you can go directly to this by linear transformation. Now, the other half is that these basic polynomials or polynomials of binomial type actually come from some combinatorial structures. Okay, for example, in the case x to the power of n, this is actually just saying all functions or all maps going from this set to this set. So the set 1, 2, 3 up until n to the set 1, 2, 3 up until x. Okay, so this is an interpretation. I mean, there are several for each one. There's, so like this case is also all these functions f, but that are 1 to 1. So that's what the lower factorials represent, and so on. So this is really what is happening on this other side. So these polynomials of binomial type arise through combinatorial analysis by the counting of some combinatorial structures. Now, the last part I was missing in this link is the connection between Gontaro polynomials and those structures. And this is where my work came in. So this is what I did majorly for my dissertation. And what I was able to show is what I'll talk about next in the next slide. And that is to say that we can actually find a combinatorial interpretation for any generic sequence of generalized Gontaro polynomials. So I'll talk about that next. Okay, so my main result is that the Gontaro polynomials actually help us count the interpretation, which I talked about, is the number of block labelings of partitions. So a partition of a set is essentially a partition where you divide a set into various blocks, and the union of those blocks is the set itself. And so that the set of partitions gives a partially ordered set, but not just a partially ordered set, actually a lattice, which is called the partition lattice. So that's where this word comes from, the partition lattice. And so it turns out that the Gontaro polynomials can be realized can be realized as the number of block labelings of partitions in this lattice whose labels are U parking functions. Of course, but we're also counting by weight. And that's where this W comes from. And this equality here is essentially saying that shift invariance. So it means that I really don't have to look at these for all x. I just need to look at the constant terms of the Gontaro polynomials and look at the negative value of our u in this u parking functions, or the negative value of what we call our grid. So essentially, what my results showed here is that we have a full combinatorial interpretation for Gontaro polynomials, as counting for us this combinatorial structures that arise from partition lattices. Okay, and of course, you can find some kind of concrete realization for this in some different structures. One of them is called exponential families, but I'll not go into much detail about that here. Okay, so just as an example, I'll talk next about this example. All right, so like, this example here tells us that if you use the recurrence, which I talked about, the linear recurrence that takes you from the basic polynomials, or what we call, it's actually called the zeta-type polynomials, but I won't go into more detail. So if you use that recurrence, this is what you will count, okay? And essentially this value here is saying when it's calculated when w is zero, so I should put when w equals zero, okay? But let me, in general, what this looks like is for T2 of W, this should be plus W2 times Z0, where, again, like I said, the W indicates a weight by which we're counting. So, but if you put W to be zero, then this part goes away. And this is what we have. Excuse me. Now, this picture counts for us the combinatorial meaning I just talked about. So if you look at this right here, what this is saying is that these are all parking functions, okay? Labelings of a block consisting of, you have two blocks, okay? Let's say one is one, one is two, and you want to label them by this set one, two, three, up until, let's say x, okay? And your z's, sub zero is somewhere here, z sub one is somewhere here. Okay, and so, well, z's, of course, z zero is less or equal to zero. So what this is saying is that I'm giving a label to each of these blocks, essentially. And so if you count here, you have 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, Z naught up until 1, Z1. This requirement just says that the smallest term is bounded above by Z naught, the next term is bounded above by Z1. And that's what you see here. So when you count, this top rectangle gives you Z naught times Z1. Okay? And this rectangle here also gives you Z naught by Z1. That is exactly where this 2Z naught Z1 comes from. But take note, I counted this block twice. So this block is exactly Z naught squared, and that's why we have it. So it's telling us that the Kochar polynomial actually helps count all these labelings of these blocks that give you Z pattern functions. And each of, when you plug W2, you get different variations of the generalized pattern function. So essentially that's what that result says. And it says that Kochar polynomials are a nice basis for working with generalized Frankenstein functions. Okay, I hope this is clear enough. All right, let's move ahead and then talk about parking completions. So parking completions are a little bit different from parking or are a generalization of parking functions in the sense that here, not every spot is empty. A number of spots, we assume that there's something on a number of spots that makes them unavailable to park on. So for example, you can say that maybe there's a trailer on M of the N spots, and you want to kind of determine what are the possible preferences for the N minus M cars so that they can all successfully park on this street. So those kind of sequences are called parking completions for a sequence. Actually, it turns out that these parking completions are actually vector parking functions, which I talked about. They're actually vector parking functions. Except that, remember when we talked about this U, we said that this is a non-decreasing sequence. In other words, U1 can be less or equal to U2, less or equal to, and so on, less or equal to UM. Now, parking completions are essentially vector parking functions where each of your U's of I's are distinct. Okay, and it turns out that we can count these things, and that's what I'll talk about next. But let me give an example of how this works. So let's look at this street like we did before. Let's look at the street. Okay, so this street has length 7, okay? And we're going to assume that this bold T, that is the things in the parentheses here, represent the spots that are taken. So let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is spot 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. So this says that spot 2 is taken. Okay, so, and then this says spot 4 is taken, and this says spot 5 is taken. Well, we then want to park according to this preference sequence. So this says car 1, so there are 4 cars, right, wanting to park on this street. Car 1, car 2, car 3, and car 4. So let me change the pen color here. Okay. So this says that car 1 wants to park in spot 1. That's fine. So car 2 wants spot 4, but it's taken, so it has to move forward. So car 2 parks in spot 6. Car 3 wants to park on spot 6, but 6 is already occupied by car 2. So it moves to the next one and parks here. And then the last car wants to park in spot 2, and so it moves forward to spot 3, and it's able to park. So we say that this sequence is a parking completion for this T. All right. What about 1746? Well, we'll show that this is not a parking completion for the same T. So let's see. If you have, again, a street with spots 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Again, as before, spot 2 is taken, spot 4 is taken, spot 5 is taken. And then we want to park based on this preference. So let's see what happens. Okay. So let's see. Let me use my row. So the first car wants to park on spot 1. That's fine. The second car wants spot 7. That's good. Now, the third car wants spot 4, which is occupied. So it has to move forward until it gets to spot 6. And lastly, the fourth car wants to park in spot 6. Now, spot 6 is occupied. It moves to 7, and then it has to leave the street. Because remember, it's a one-way street. So car 4 is unable to park. And that's why we say this is not a parking completion for this T. So I hope that this picture makes it clear. All right. So let's move to the next slide. So essentially, this is our main result of parking completions, is that the number of parking completions for any given set of taking spots T, where you have T is T1, T2 up until TM, in your set 1, 2, 3 up until N. So our street has N spots, and spots T1, T2 up until TM are taken. The number of parking completions is given by this expression here, which is the sum over this L. And we'll talk about this set where L is coming from. You're doing N minus M, choose L, and you're multiplying over the product of all parking completions, okay, of length LJ. So this, remember that the number of parking, sorry, let me say that again. The product ranging from J equals 1 to M plus 1 of all parking functions of size L sub J. And because remember we said that L sub J plus 1 to the L sub J minus 1 is the number of parking completion, parking functions of length L sub J. And that's really what this is. Now, I said I'll talk about what this set is. This set is a set of all compositions, maybe actually weak compositions. So weak compositions of N minus M. In other words, L1 plus L2 plus up until plus Lm plus 1, L sub M plus 1 is N minus M. And as you sum up, the first J terms of this L is bounded below by T sub J minus J. So because where your T sub J is coming from here. So this essentially is the number of all parking completions. And there are more results where to find the number of increasing parking completions. This is essentially replacing this by the number of increasing parking functions of length L sub J, which is C sub J. Remember the number, Catalan number. All right. I will not go more further details of this, but I'll leave it here and then go ahead to talk about parking sequence. All right, so what are parking sequences? These are another set of generalizations of parking functions. But this time around, every car can have different sizes. So before, up until this point, we have looked at all cars having size 1. Now, parking sequences was a generalization introduced by Professor Ehrenberg and his student Alex Happ at the University of Kentucky, where they looked at the case where you have a street and you have cars of different sizes wanting to park on that street. And each car has a preference. Now, the parking process is kind of similar to what we looked at earlier, except that this time around, you have to take into cognizance the length of each car. So each car comes in at their preference C sub I, and they check for the first open spot. Now, when they get the first open spot, they look from that spot to the next Y sub I spot. Okay, in essence, they probe from that spot J to all the first YI spots after J that can occupy the car. And if all of those spots are empty, then the car parks. Otherwise, the car has to leave. Okay, so this is really a generalization because when your Y sub I's are 1, this process reduces to the original process we talked about at the beginning. Okay, so again, examples help illuminate things clearer. So let's talk about this example. So think of the example 2784. So we will say that this is a parking sequence for the length vector 1, 2, 3, 2. So this means car 1 has length 1, car 2 has length 2, car 3 has length 3, in this case, and car 4 has length 2. And this 4 here represents a trailer. So one thing I did not say is that in this generalization, there can be a trailer at the start of the street. So usually we would denote this trailer by T and capital T, and we would say it has size Z minus 1. And it's Z minus 1 because of something I would say shortly. Okay, so let's see what this looks like for C to be a parking sequence for this length vector. So we'll call this Y our length vector. So let me write this here. So we'll say that this right here, up until this, is Y, is the vector Y. So this is our length vector. So this is called our length vector. Okay, and this is your Z. Okay, so you will see this being written as PS. The set of all parking sequences will be noted by PS of Y semicolon Z. All right, so again, remember that the trailer T has length Z minus 1. So T has length Z minus 1. So in this case, the trailer has length 3. And the trailer is always parked at the start of the street. Okay, so let's see what happens here. We want to park 4 cars on this street with 11 spots using this preference. So C1, C2, C3, C4. So each of these cars have this preference. So car 1 has preference 2 and has length 1. So let's see. It starts here and then goes for the first open spot, which happens to be this 4. And so it parks here. Car 2 has preference 7. So at this point, 7 is open. And so car 2 starts at 7 to park, but it has length 2. So it occupies these next 2 spots. Okay, so now we have 4 is occupied, 7 and 8 are occupied. And then let's look at car 3, has preference 8. So it enters the street as 8, but it's occupied. So it looks for the first open spot, which is 9. When it goes to 9, 9 is open, 10 is open, 11 is open. And car 3 specifically has size 3. So it parks on these 3 spots. That's all. And lastly, the fourth car has preference 4. Well, it has size 2. So 4 is occupied by car 1 already. So it moves to 5 to start to park. But since it has size 2, it can park on these 2 spots. And so we say that 2, 7, 8, 4 is a parking sequence for this vector Y and with the trailer Z. I hope this is clear. Okay, that's really what we described here. Now, one thing that immediately shows up here is that a permutation of a parking sequence might not be a parking sequence. And for example, let's look at this sequence here, 2, 7, 4, 8. So we looked at 2, 7, 8, 4, and we just look at this rearrangement. Okay, 2, 7, 4, 8. Assuming we're trying to park on this same street, what would happen? Okay, car 1 wants to park in spot 2. It moves to 4, so it parks. Okay, so this is car 1. Car 2, so let me put it in a box. Okay, car 1. Car 2 wants to park in spot 7, so it parks there as before because 7 and 8 are open. Car 3 wants to park in spot 4. Now, spot 4 is occupied, but 5 is open. So, excuse me. So it starts to park in spot 5. However, the size of car 3 is 3, which means it needs 3 open spots, but the only 2 are open. And so it means car 3 is unable to park. And it means that this, therefore, is not a parking sequence. So once one car fails to park, that sequence is not a parking sequence. Okay. So the result by Ehrenberg and Happ says that you can actually count parking sequences given any Y and any trailer of size Z minus 1. And it's given by the product Z times z plus y1 plus n minus 1 times z plus y1 plus y2 plus n minus 2 and so on up until z plus y1 plus up until plus y sub n minus 1 plus 1. So this product is exactly the number of all packet sequences for the length sequence y and the trailer of size z minus 1. Okay. So let me talk about my work together with my with Dr. Yan on increasing packing sequences. So I looked at increasing packing sequences specifically and increasing and invariant packing sequences. And I'll talk about invariant packing sequences in a little bit. But increasing packing sequences are essentially packing sequences, sequences that are non-decreasing and are also packing sequences. So let me warn here that it's possible to have a sequence that is a packing sequence, but whose increasing or non-decreasing rearrangement is not a packing sequence. So you can try out some examples and see, but because of time, I won't go into that. But essentially, to be an increasing packing sequence, you have to be an increasing sequence, and then you have to be a packing sequence. Okay, so. Well, earlier I talked about dyke paths and labeled dyke paths. So these are just examples of lattice paths. And one more example of a lattice path is lattice paths with strict right boundary. And I'll just explain using this example. So this is an example of a lattice path with strict right boundary at 3, 4, 5, and 8. Okay, that's what we have here. So this path, I can actually represent it by just looking at where the knot steps are taking. Okay, so essentially that's how I have this 2, 3, 3, and then 7. So I can represent it by this. Now it turns out that there's a bijection, and this is our result. There's a bijection between set of increasing packing sequences and all lattice paths with strict right boundary, where your strict right boundary is given by this value. Z plus y1 plus y2, and so on, and the last term here is z plus y1 plus y2 up until yn minus 1. And it turns out that there's a nice determinant formula that we can get, you know, that gives us what this number is, where your bi's are your strict right boundaries, like I said. All right, so this is really one part of my work on increasing packing sequences. The other part has to do with invariance. So what is invariant? What are invariant packing sequences? Remember earlier that I said a permutation of a packing sequence is not necessarily a packing sequence. And so the question arises, in packing functions, we know permutation of all packing functions are packing functions. But the same is not true for packing sequences. So the question is, which packing sequences are invariant under rearrangement? And we studied several cases. So the answer to this question in general is not very straightforward, and so we kind of looked at several cases. And so the first case is when you have a constant sequence, okay, which is a just straight direct generalization of when your sizes are, you know, the packing functions case. So if you have a scarce of all constant lengths, then it turns out that the number, what we showed is that number of packing, invariant packing sequences for this case will be z into n plus z to the n minus 1. So the size of the car really doesn't matter. And it's interesting to see that, of course, when you put your s to be equal to 1, and where there's no trailer, which is really the case of packing functions, then this specializes to the case n plus 1 to the n minus 1, which is what we want. Okay, we also looked at the case where your length vector is strictly increasing, okay? And in this case, we get that this sequence gives us this packing, invariant packing sequence, since the set of invariant packing sequences is exactly all packing sequences that have preferences coming from this set. So each of the n preferences come from this set. And that's why the number is given by this z to the n. Now, there's one more example, which is the very interesting case, which I want to talk about next. And that's the case where you have two sets of sizes. So there are some cars of size A and some other cars of size B, where A, in this case, A, specifically A, is less than B. So we will call these cars that have size A, we'll call them A cars. And the cars of size B, we'll call them B cars. So there are R A cars and there are N minus R B cars, okay? And essentially, we want to know how many invariant parking sequences do you have for this length vector? So let me talk about that. Okay, so my result here, my advice really is that the set of invariant parking sequences is in bijection with the set of all U parking functions, where your U is given by this sequence of Z's and then Z plus 1, Z plus 2 up until Z plus R minus 1. So there are N minus R plus 1 Z's, and then the remaining R terms are just Z plus 1, Z plus 2, and so on. And there is a bijection here. And the beautiful thing about it is that we can count. And so, because we know the number of parking functions that is given by this, we can exactly count them here by this sum, which is summing over all j going from 0 to r minus 1, n choose j, times r minus j times r to the j minus 1 times z to the n minus j. Now, the beautiful part here is that this formula does not involve A and B. So the sizes of the car are irrelevant in this case. And so that's a really beautiful result. And again, at the end, I'll post links so that you can be able to look at, to my website, so that you can look at the papers where these results come from. So I want to stop here, but before I stop, I'll talk about future directions of things I'm interested in working on going forward. So just from the previous slide, I said that in this case, your A is less than B. Okay, that's what we have here. So the question one might want to ask is, what happens when A is greater than B? And that's a really good question. We have some results for a special case, but we want to get a result in general when A is greater than B. Now, in this case, it also turns out that the invariant set here is dependent on your A and your B. We don't know what the count will be, but we know it's not exactly like the previous. So this would be another interesting case to investigate. Also, want to look at what are other special cases of length vectors. So when our length vector takes other special cases that we haven't covered here, what happens? And these are things, the problems I want to look at for parking sequences. Going back to parking completions, I also like to look at the case where a length vector can be anything. So essentially, remember I said parking completions, trailers park at different spots on the street, and each car has size one, because these are like parking, generalized parking functions. And so I would like to look at the case where each car can have different lengths, like in the Ehrenberg half case that we looked at, and there are trailers parked at different spots. So not just at the beginning of the street, but at different parts of the street. So this combines work from parking sequences and our work from parking completions. So these are some things I would like to look at going forward. So again, thank you for the opportunity to give this talk. And if anyone has questions, please feel free to email me at the email showing here on your screen, ayoijeng@gmail.com. And definitely, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Okay. All right, so I'll stop here. And in the next video, I'll be answering the questions that I was asked to answer by Professor Sumani that will help you. I'll talk about specifically questions that have to do with me and mathematics. All right. Mm-hmm.